portion of this video is brought to you by Incogni. The southwestern U.S. is in the throes of a mega drought so severe that we've broken the record. All 1,200 years of it. According to a study published earlier this year, soil hasn't been this dry since the scientific record began around the year 800. This has major implications for the country's food supply, as we rely on the West Coast state of California to produce over one-third of U.S.'s vegetables and three-quarters of its fruits and nuts. However, researchers from the University of California have proposed a solution that could potentially address both the water and energy crisis at the same time, covering irrigation canals with solar panels. But is this just another renewable gimmick, or does it hold a little more water? Let's take a deeper dive to find out. I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. We talk a lot about solar, and for good reason. It's a strong contender in the renewable energy race. That said, we'd be remiss if we didn't acknowledge some of the drawbacks. For one, these photovoltaic panels have to go somewhere, and the available room is finite. We'll get to how solar can help with water in just a minute, but the challenge around space is important for context. Take India, for example. Coal-fired power plants generated 72% of the country's electricity between 2018 and 2019. At the same time, the country has 300 sunny days in a year, and a large population that could benefit massively from the reliable, abundant source of clean energy. The problem is, there's not a lot of places to collect it. Land is relatively expensive in India, and its high population density, with an average of 464 people per square kilometer, further complicates this. Rooftop solar can only go so far with limited sunny building space. But when implemented strategically, dual-use options like agrivoltaics show that symbiotic relationship between solar panels and their surrounding environments are possible. We've seen this play out in farms where plants grow directly beneath solar panels are not only shielded from wind and storms, but use significantly less water in the shade. In turn, the crops themselves actually keep themselves cooler, which helps them run better. I've got another video on this if you want to check it out. I'll put a link in the description. That's because, despite their purpose, solar panels don't like it hot. Their electrical components perform the best at below 25 degrees Celsius, or about 77 degrees Fahrenheit, and have an efficiency rate of about 20%. Solar panels lose anywhere from 0.3% to 0.5% efficiency for every degree over 25 degrees Celsius. As a result, the negative effects on efficiency worsen significantly in areas where temperatures can climb into ranges of about 50 degrees Celsius or 122 degrees Fahrenheit. So what does this have to do with canals? Well, this is where water comes into the picture, and as you can probably imagine, sticking a solar farm over open water takes temperature optimization to the next level. In fact, the resulting cooling effect means an efficiency of up to 15% higher than that of classic landlocked solar, according to the Environmental and Energy Study Institute. Welcome to the world of floating photovoltaic panels, or floatovoltaics, also known as floating solar farms. Now, floatovoltaics are kind of like the Murphy beds of the solar world, just not as comfortable. Now, when you add solar panels to open water, you get all the perks of renewable energy while using previously squandered surface area. And as for the placement of floating solar farms, man-made bodies of water like aqueducts, canals, and reservoirs are what you want. That's because they're generally calm, relatively easy to access, and less disruptive to aquatic life. Most importantly, these pools of water offer unused workspace. I mean, nobody wants to build a condominium on top of a canal. At least, not yet. And don't give them any ideas. Now, combining hydropower with floating solar is one example. Most hydropower dams have a nearby lake to hold excess water. Floating solar can be easily installed on these lakes and directly send electricity to the already existing infrastructure at the plant, meaning you get more energy production with just a few tweaks. The potential impact of using photovoltaics in tandem with hydro is nothing to sneeze at. In a Nature article published in June, researchers estimate that covering just 10% of the world's hydropower reservoirs with solar panels would create almost 4,000 gigawatts of solar capacity. This is equivalent to the electricity generation capacity of all of the fossil fuel-based plants in the world. Nevertheless, it's important to note that photovoltaics aren't completely appropriate for every biome, and they might still need to be supplemented with other sources of renewable energy, depending on their location. But where they do work best, a little goes a long way. Research based on the projected demand for solar energy by 2050 estimates that countries like Brazil and Canada would only need about 5% of the reservoirs covered by panels to meet their needs. But how exactly can floating solar help solve the water crisis? Before I get to that, I'd like to thank Incogni for sponsoring this portion of today's video. It wasn't that long ago that I signed up for a newsletter from a company that I'm not going to name who, but after I did, I saw a major increase in the number of promotional emails that I was receiving from companies I've never heard of. And that's because they sold my information to a data broker. I've also had my information leaked through data breaches at companies like Target, Sony, and others many times, and I'm sure you have too. Now, Incogni can help you with this. We have the right to request that data brokers delete our information, but it takes a lot of time and effort. I signed up for Incogni, gave them the legal right to work on my behalf, and then just sat back and relaxed. You'll see updates on your account for which data brokers they've sent legal requests to and which ones have complied. It couldn't be easier. I've been letting Incogni stay on top of this for me for quite a while now, and I'm very happy with the results. If you want to take back some of the control around who has access to your personal information, give Incogni a try. The first 100 people to use the code UNDECIDED at the link below will get 20% off Incogni. Thanks to Incogni and to all of you for supporting the channel. Now back to how floating solar can help with the water crisis. Canal top photovoltaics in particular are especially advantageous under hot conditions, which are of course intensifying thanks to climate change. Now remember our conundrum with solar energy in India that we talked about earlier? In the state of Gujarat, rising temperatures are causing increased water stress as irrigation canals dry up. Covering a canal in solar panels, though, not only produces clean energy and saves space, but helps to protect the water from evaporation. That's why engineers began to capitalize on the space atop canals along the state's Narmada River during a floating solar pilot project launched in 2012. By its completion, solar panels covered a 750-meter stretch of the canals. This led to the first large-scale canal-top solar power plant in the Vidodara district in 2015 for $18.3 million. Since that first foray into photovoltaics in Gujarat, at least 8 Indian states have commissioned canal solar projects. This includes a 100-megawatt farm that covers about 40 kilometers at an estimated cost of 1 billion Indian rupees, or about $13.9 million. The United States has also dipped its toes into floating solar. In 2018, the CL and Terra Company completed installation of the country's first public floating solar array in Kelseyville County, California. This 252-kilowatt farm consists of 720 solar panels that float on a man-made wastewater treatment pond. On the opposite coast, the Big Muddy Lake Solar Farm in Fort Bragg was the U.S. Army's first floating structure. Installed in June of this year, this 1.1-megawatt setup is the largest of its kind in southeastern U.S. and currently powers 190 homes and 2 megawatt hours of battery storage. Currently, the largest floating solar farm in the states lives in California, the Healdsburg Floating Solar Farm. Now, this 44.8-megawatt farm sits in two ponds that span 15 acres, and it provides 8% of Healdsburg's annual electricity requirement. It also uses double-sided solar panels to catch the overhead sunlight and the rays that reflect back off the water. As the southwest U.S. faces a mega drought, the water conservation aspects of floating solar are extremely relevant in California. When you consider its water insecurity and notoriously polluted air, the state has a lot to lose. At the moment, it's gradually taking steps to run on carbon-free electricity by 2045. It also happens to have the world's largest water conveyance system, where 4,000 miles of irrigation canals distribute water to farmers across the state. In a 2021 study, researchers from the University of California determined that covering those miles with solar panels could save upwards of 63 billion gallons of water each year through reduced evaporation. This is equivalent to the residential water needs of about 2 million people, or enough to irrigate about 50,000 acres of farmland. On top of this, it's estimated that if all of California's canals and aqueducts were covered with solar panels, they would generate 13 gigawatts of solar energy, which is about half of what it needs to meet its clean energy goals. That's a great sentiment, but how do we know it's practical? Well, that's where Project Nexus comes in. As the first venture of its kind in the States, Project Nexus is actually the real-life testing phase of the University of California's research. Taking direct inspiration from Gujarat, the plan is to install open-sided solar panel canopies over California's canals in the Turlock Irrigation District by the end of 2023. This pilot phase is meant to prove the viability of the concept, and the project now has $20 million backing in the state's current budget, with construction expected to start this fall. As for how testing will work, the goal is to install about 8,500 feet of solar panels over 3 sections of the Turlock Irrigation District's canals. Now, the canals range in width from 20 to 100 feet. Researchers will monitor factors that impact productivity, like the difference between cable suspension and steel truss support mounting, and the performance of monofacial versus bifacial solar panel designs. They'll also examine storage solutions to support the local electric grid during outages and cloud cover. The project uses existing infrastructure on already disturbed land to keep costs low and efficiency high, all while supporting the region's sustainable farming tradition. Plus, the canals in California can use 50% less raw materials than the ones in India, and they can also be designed to allow more space around the panels for easier maintenance. The actual scale of these installations is actually pretty small in the grand scheme of things. Of the 4,000 miles of canals statewide, the panels for Project Nexus will only cover about 2 of them, producing about 5 megawatts of power. Still, this sets the perfect stage for researchers to watch how the benefits of this technology develop in real time. So what are the pros and cons? Well, let's start with the good. There's no doubt floating solar is a viable way to install solar panels in a way that's less intrusive upon local ecosystems or residential areas. Normally, solar farms take up at least 20 times more land as a fossil fuel power plant to produce a single gigawatt of electricity. But in the case of floating solar, you don't need to clear a bunch of trees and otherwise disturb large swaths of land to install your panels. Just look at Gujarat. According to the Gujarat State Electricity Corporation, if just 30% of its 80,000 kilometers of canals were converted to solar, you could produce 18,000 megawatts of power and save 90,000 acres of land at the same time. The adaptability of photovoltaics is what really makes them stand out. You can technically put solar panels in any body of water that you want. Oceans, lakes, reservoirs, a large puddle. The opportunity cost of building some solar panels on some of these sites can be relatively low, especially on reservoirs or surfaces that don't get used for much of anything else. If it sits idle and doesn't have any other uses, then you're practically wasting watery real estate otherwise. Making use of existing infrastructures is more impactful when you take into consideration the fact that developers can skip extensive environmental permitting and right-of-way issues. That means that they can install these systems more quickly and cheaply without as much red tape in the way. There's a boost to the overall infrastructure as well. The energy generated from canal top solar can provide electricity for farmers during the energy-intensive irrigation season, and the out-of-season electricity can be fed into the state grid, reducing transmission losses and strengthening the local grid. Covering the canal isn't just conserving water, it can also improve the quality of that water underneath too. The shade from the panels can reduce weed growth and algae blooms by blocking sunlight from penetrating the surface. These algae blooms are a common headache for the companies that manage the water delivery gates, as weed and algae overgrowth can clog the water pumps and raise maintenance costs. Reducing weed growth in canals could lead to saving as much as $40,000 in maintenance costs per mile of canal. Algae and weeds aren't the only unwanted guests floating solar panels can help keep at bay. The shade beneath the panels lessens the number of microorganisms swimming below, improving overall quality and increasing the safety of potable water. Installing floating solar panels is also relatively easy, sometimes more than land or roof-based systems. All you have to do is assemble and anchor them in place. So here's the multi-million dollar question, what's the catch? As good as this all sounds, there's some challenges. For one, not any canal will do. Factors like wind speed, water currents, and the direction of the sun all need to be considered when you're installing floating solar. Meandering canals can be especially tricky for this because ideally you want solar panels to face south, but a canal's direction is already set. The dimensions of the canal that you use also matters too. Too wide of a stretch and construction becomes more expensive and challenging. Too narrow and the amount of panels that you can install is reduced, restricting the production off the bat. Now you can make some physical changes to the area, for example, trees along the canal often have to be cut down to keep the area free from shade, but naturally that adds to environmental and cost concerns. And like any other solar panel, floating arrays need to be cleaned on a regular basis. Any gunk that accumulates on top can lead to a decrease in production, and you run the risk of silt buildup from the water itself, depending on where you install them. With this extra exposure to the elements, you need to build in a way to easily access these floating panels, like ramps to select locations, in order to allow for regular access. In more remote areas, some companies have used sprayers and robots to clean the panels on a regular basis. Floating solar panels also share the same disadvantages as their terrestrial counterparts, namely the intermittency of solar access, the not-so-clean extraction and production of the materials used to make them, and the need to keep them well-maintained in order to glean enough energy to keep them productive for their entire lifespan. But worst of all, canal-top solar plants are more expensive to build than the normal solar plants at this point in their development. Estimates vary, but costs can be as much as 10 to 15% higher than land-based solar panels. The bill for installation is generally higher due to the special materials like galvanized supports to prevent corrosion, the floats themselves, and the niche installation techniques needed to get everything working properly. Once you consider operation and maintenance costs, though, everything kind of evens out a bit. Floating solar involves more complicated maintenance. After all, you have to get to these arrays with appendages like anchors and mooring setups that will need extra attention. Still, with all the water around, you don't need extensive fencing or specialized vegetation, which is often needed and installed for terrestrial solar to help keep the panels cool. In the end, Project Nexus and similar experiments are putting the long-term cost savings to the test. This magic number can be represented by a net present value, or NPV. At simplest, NPV is a measure of the financial worth of an investment. And University of California researchers calculated the NPV of canal-top solar potentially exceeds conventional terrestrial solar by 20 to 50%. That figure changes depending on the exact type of canal-top solar that you're using. Plants built with tension cables, for example, may have a higher NPV than a ground-mounted facility when you consider in the additional costs that can be offset by water conservation, decreased land use, and reduced aquatic weed maintenance. Researchers have found that you can't say the same for plants built with a steel truss. Some experts aren't quite so convinced about canal-top solar, though. Ellen Bruno, an economist at the Department of Agriculture and Resource Economics at the University of California, believes that the cost of building solar over California's canals would still add up to be larger than the potential savings made through reduced water evaporation. Whether or not the cumulative impact of water conservation and clean energy production would do the trick is still to be determined. There is some hope on the horizon. Over the array's lifespan, the Turlock District anticipates that it will recoup the installation cost of the canal top solar within 8 years of operation. There are also other ways to mitigate these costs, like tax breaks and cash rebates. Regardless, one thing is certain: to compete with large-scale terrestrial installations in the long run, canal top solar needs to achieve a similar levelized cost of energy in order to be a feasible way forward. So with all of this in mind, is floating solar the best of both worlds? Well, Californians might be able to cash in on a 3-for-1 deal: an estimated reduction in evaporation of up to 82%, clean energy, and maximizing precious space. The benefits are intriguing, especially in locations facing increased drought seasons and tighter squeezes across terrain. It's certainly not a one-size-fits-all type solution, but in places like California and India, canal-top solar promises a win-win-win: a valuable source of clean energy that can conveniently integrate into the environment and improve it. So are you still undecided? Do you think solutions like solar canals are a good idea? Jump in the comments and let me know. And be sure to check out my follow-up podcast, Still to Be Determined, where we'll be discussing some of your feedback. If you like this video, be sure to check out one of the ones over here. And thanks to all of my patrons for your continued support, and welcome to new Supporter Plus member, John Sostrom. And thanks to all of you for watching. I'll see you in the next one.